This episode is sponsored by Raycon. A 47-year-old woman went in for x-rays at Henry Ford Hospital in Detroit, complaining of pain in her lower back, legs, and hips. Over the last few years, her teeth had grown more and more brittle and started chipping off at the slightest impact. Eventually, all of her teeth had to be removed. When doctors asked her about her lifestyle habits, she noted that for the last 17 years, she had been consuming a single pitcher of black tea, made using between 100 to 150 tea bags every single day. That's a strong brew. You know, I'm almost jealous. What was the cause behind her back pain? Could it be connected to her insane tea drinking habits? Could the secret behind this drama be the very water she was drinking? Or could it be something even more sinister? Let's get into it. I like a stiff drink, but over 100 teabags for a single pitcher of tea is excessive. But could it be behind her hellish hospital visit? After x-rays were taken, doctors noted that her spine and legs showed calcification in the membranes between her bones, meaning that the soft, outside parts of her bones hardened unnaturally. They also wrote that she showed signs of a condition called rugger jersey spine, which, as the name suggests, makes your spine look like a striped jersey. On the x-rays, her bones appeared to have dense sections, which the doctors feared was cancer. She was referred to Dr. Rao, an endocrinologist specializing in bone health, in order to confirm or deny this cancer diagnosis. After studying the x-rays, Dr. Rao was able to recognize it immediately as an acute case of skeletal fluorosis.
Whoa, what's skeletal fluorosis?
Great question. Fluorosis, skeletal or dental, are conditions characterized by high fluoride levels building up in the body. Dental fluorosis can be diagnosed by staining and pitting of the teeth, and in severe cases, your enamel can become damaged. In skeletal fluorosis, fluoride builds up in the bones over many years, leading to stiffness and pain in your joints. In bad cases, your bone structure may change, and your ligaments may calcify, resulting in paralysis or brittle bones. In very severe cases, skeletal fluorosis can spread to the skull, and a brittle skull is never a good thing, especially if you want to keep your soft, squishy brain intact. In fact, in Jharkhand, a northeastern region in India, as many as 36 people have died from skull fluorosis in the past decade. Skeletal fluorosis occurs when one consumes low levels of fluoride over a very long time. So, in terms of our case, how did so much fluoride get into her system? You know what I don't mind having too much in my system? Today's sponsor, Raycon, and super cool dope beats!
Hey, bro, are you talking about how great Raycon's everyday earbuds are without us?
Yeah, they're great when you're out shopping and just want a little privacy.
I don't need to worry about no Karen, but I've got my favorite ska bands, crisp and clear, right in my ear.
You listen to ska too?
Raycon's everyday earbuds have optimized gel tips for the perfect in-ear fit. They're comfy and cool to look at.
With 8 hours of playtime and 32 hours of battery life, I can have a ska-nominal ska experience all day long. I can share my favorite dance moves with my boys at the touch of a button with the built-in mic.
Raycon's everyday earbuds are half the price of the other premium earbuds on the market and sound just as good. So all the money you save can go toward checkerboard sneakers and suspenders.
You can borrow mine if you want.
Raycon even has a 45-day happiness guarantee if you're not completely satisfied.
Click the link in the description box or go to buyraycon.com/brew to get up to 20% off your Raycon purchase. Ska music not included. What is fluoride? And why is the man making me drink it? Okay, so some of you may already be aware that there is fluoride in drinking water. But do you know why? To find this out, we need to go back to an ancient and bygone era. The late 1970s. At that time, the majority of middle-class Americans above 60 years old were expected to lose their teeth and need a full set of dentures. Today, most middle-class Americans keep their teeth well into their 80s, and, according to dentists, this is because of mass fluoridation, or, in other words, the practice of putting fluoride into community drinking water. Journalist Charles Mann, in an article for The Atlantic, notes that upon mentioning fluoridation on social media, people I did not know troubled themselves to tell me that I was an idiot and that fluoridation was terrible, which prompted him to ask, how much fluoride is in my water and how did public health officials set the dose? Dosage is super important for all things medical, and mass fluoridation is no different. Children are particularly susceptible to fluoride poisoning, which is consuming too much fluoride too quickly, characterized by immediate abdominal pain, excessive salivation, vomiting, seizures, and muscle spasms. Children's bodies are generally smaller than adults, which puts them at risk of higher concentrations of any given substance. Health officials in North America, where most of us drink tap water, must take into account the child who drinks a lot of it, and lower the dose accordingly. But if they lower the dose, does it still help full-grown adults who can tolerate a much higher concentration? To find the answer, we need to know how we found out that fluoride aided dental health in the first place. It all begins with the increased availability of sugar in the early 20th century, with increased global trade. In the first few decades, dentists would regularly create full sets of dentures for teenagers so they could look nice in pictures at their high school graduations. American soldiers even had to pass a dental exam, proving that they had at least 6 teeth on the top and bottom of their jaws. This is where dentist Frederick McKay comes in. In 1901, while he was practicing in Colorado Springs, McKay noticed that many of his patients' teeth were dotted with brown stains. He collaborated with another dentist, and they found that students at Colorado College in Colorado Springs had discolored teeth, where students from other regions did not. Nearly 30 years later, McKay finally identified what was staining people's teeth. It was naturally occurring fluoride in water supplies leaching out of calcium deposits in aquifers. Yes, fluoride is natural. What really blew their minds was that people who had fluoride stains also had fewer dental issues. And by fewer dental issues, I mean they had more teeth. If you're still a little skeptical about fluoridation, wait until you hear that commercial fluoride is a compound of a substance called fluorine, which is lethal in small doses and immensely reactive. Fluorides are a waste product of certain industrial processes, including the production of glass, fertilizers, aluminum, and pesticides, among other things. Industrial executives were, elated when they found out that the waste product they paid to dispose of that was believed to poison water supplies could be sold for profit by putting it into water supplies. So, large industries in America began spending more money to fund research on the link between fluoride and reduced cavities. Then, in 1945, the cities of Grand Rapids, Michigan, and Newburgh, New York, both added fluoride to their water in a pilot project to see the effects of mass fluoridation on city populations. For both cities, a nearby city that did not add fluoride to water supplies was chosen as a control. The tests were intended to extend for a decade, so researchers could examine the long-term effects. But less than 10 years into the experiment, one of the control cities fluoridated its water at the behest of its citizens who had heard about the positive effects from tests in other cities. And so, mass fluoridation began in earnest, and everything was good forever, and no one ever had to go to the dentist ever again. Unfortunately not, but fluoridation did correlate with a decrease in tooth decay among countries that adopted mass fluoridation in the last 50 years. Upon fluoridation, instances of tooth decay decreased almost immediately. However, instances of tooth decay in non-fluoridated countries like Belgium, Luxembourg, and Denmark have also been decreasing over the last 50 years, not to mention that they have better dental care than the US. Part of this trend is thanks to the growing robustness of government-funded dental programs in some countries, and the increased use of fluoridated toothpaste. However, these trends only appear in the last 50 years. Fluoridation did improve dental health, but there are other factors at play these days. So, now the argument in favor of fluoridation is basically that fluoridation in the smallest possible dosages will benefit those who do not have access to good dental care with the least harm to the rest of the population. Howard Pollack, an ADA spokesperson and dental scientist at UC San Francisco School of Dentistry, says that water systems are operated by professionals. With the new equipment, they can control the fluoride level within a very narrow range, and he believed that it is safe for public health. That being said, it's impossible to account for individual sensitivity to fluoride. So, as long as mass fluoridation is in effect, there will always be some who are negatively affected. So, is mass fluoridation the cause behind our case's skeletal fluorosis? No. However, skeletal fluorosis is more common in places around the world with higher levels of naturally occurring fluoride. They're commonly called fluoride belts. There is one that lingers from Syria through to Kenya, and another that stretches from Turkey to China. So, what was behind our case of skeletal fluorosis? What was pumping her full of fluoride, weakening her bones, and breaking her teeth? Well, as it turns out, black tea is one of the most common catalysts of skeletal fluorosis. The woman's blood serum concentrations of fluoride came to 0.43 milligrams per liter, which is more than 4 times higher than the normal levels. After drinking a single pitcher of tea per day, using over 100 tea bags each time, it's easy to see how quickly this got out of hand. What's more, the percentage of soluble fluoride that the gastrointestinal tract can absorb is close to 100%, meaning that very little fluoride is removed by your liver before it enters your bloodstream. I have literally no clue why she drank her tea like this. The case report doesn't say. According to registered dental hygienist Kathy Hester Seckman, Camellia sinensis, the species of plant that all teas come from, aside from herbal teas, are fluoride hyperaccumulators, which means that they absorb chemicals and heavy metals to a higher concentration than they exist in the soil around them. Tea plants will just keep sucking up all the fluoride that they can until the concentration in the plant itself is much higher. Not only that, but the older the tea plant, the more fluoride they can absorb. Typically, the cheaper the tea, the older the leaves. A study from the UK found that drinking teas that use these older leaves could provide up to 150% of one's dietary fluoride intake. Another study, based in the Republic of Ireland, took 54 brands of tea commonly sold in the country and found that the levels of fluoride sat at an average level of 3.3 milligrams per liter. When you consider that not only is the ROI the only European country with mandatory water fluoridation, but also has the highest per capita consumption of black tea on Earth. So, to return to our case, after drinking so much fluoride in her tea for 17 whole years, losing all of her teeth, and turning her spine into a striped jersey, is there any way for her to get better? Well, the good news for you and my sanity is that after speaking with medical professionals, she stopped her tea drinking habits, and soon after, her symptoms improved. It can take years for the body to remove skeletal fluoride, so her doctors considered using teriparatide, a hormone that aids in bone formation to help her recover, though the case report ends before she was discharged. So, is fluoride good for us? That's a hard question to answer, and is far more complicated than we could sum up in one video. While fluoride did improve dental health in the 20th century, dental care, education, and cleaning products were less available to the public. That being said, much of the scientific research at the time when nations were considering mass fluoridation were confounded by other factors, like socioeconomic class, sugar consumption, and sample size that researchers could not control. Today, many of us reap the benefits of a more robust healthcare system. But in the words of University of Manchester School of Dentistry researcher Anne Marie Glennie, there's no argument that fluoridation doesn't work. The question is whether it is still the right way forward. 9 out of 10 dentists recommend that if you like today's episode, you should go ahead and hit that like button and leave a comment down below. We post all the time, so subscribe and press the bell if you want to be notified whenever we have a new episode. When I find that one dentist that didn't recommend my channel...